things that you need to follow, from your when you can fly, your flight plans, to your personal licensing issues. Everything is handled under regulations. So first we'll start off with ICAO. Now, what is ICAO? ICAO is the International Civil Aviation Organization. Its headquarters is in Montreal, Canada. And the role of ICAO is to achieve uniformity and agreement between nations in technical, economic, legal, operational matters, a treaty for establishment of an international organization of on the pattern of UN was signed in December 1994 in Chicago at a convention of the states. Now, the body was named as ICAO, International Civil Aviation Organization. And the ICAO is composed of a General Assembly and a Council with 33 contracting states elected by the Assembly. The President is the head of the organization, and the Secretary General is the executive head of the council and is also assisted by a secretary. Next, we have the ICAO objectives. Now, these are the main things that ICAO looks over. ICAO is responsible to ensure the safety and orderly growth of international aviation, encourages the arts and arts of aircraft designing and operations of for peaceful purposes, encourages the development of airways, airports, and navigation facilities for international civil aviation, meets the needs of consumers for safe, regular, and economical travel. It prevents economic waste that is caused by unreasonable competition between two different airlines. And it ensures that the right of contracting states, over here when we say contracting states, it means every country is individually known as a state. So the rights of contracting states are fully respected, and that every contracting state has a fair opportunity to operate on an international in an international airline. It also helps avoid discrimination between two different states. It promotes safety on light in safety of flight in international civil aviation and aeronautics. Now we have a list of conventions that took place dating back to 1917. The first convention was Paris Convention. It was held to regulate air navigation with particular attention to sovereignty, airworthiness, competency of an air crew, definition of ATC. Then we had Chicago Convention that was held on 7th December 1944. And this convention helped develop principles and techniques for international civil aviation. 96 articles were signed on this day. Also, India was signed as a signatory to the Chicago Convention. Then we had Warsaw Convention. It deals with the responsibility for carriage of passengers, baggage, and cargo. And it was originally signed in 1929, and then it was amended in 1955 and in Netherlands, and then in 1971 in Guatemala. Then we have the Rome Convention, which deals with the damage caused by foreign aircraft or third party on the surface. And it came into effect, it was held on 7th October 1952, but it came into effect on 4th Feb 1958. Then we have the Tokyo Convention, held on 14th September 1963. It was for the offense on board against penal law, is applicable to aircraft in contracting state, and the incident should be in the contracting state, which means if the offense on board, like on your in the aircraft, it has to happen in a different state, and the incident which occurred on board also should be in the same state for it to be applicable. Then we have the Montreal Convention, 23rd September 1971. This deals with offense on board leading to damage of property of the aircraft. Okay, next, we have freedoms. So in Chicago on 7 December 1944, when the ICAR Convention was signed, they discussed on five freedoms. The first freedom is the right to fly over without landing, which means you can fly over any state meaning any country, without having to land in the country. Then the second freedom is to right to land for technical purpose, non-traffic purpose. So non-traffic purpose is when you have any technicality issues, let's say there's an emergency. So you have the right to land on in any state for a technical purpose. Then the third freedom is right to put down a passenger from home state, which means let's say India is our home state and London is the contracting state. So any airline from India has the right to put down a passenger in London. Then right to carry passengers for home state, which means an airline based from India has the right to carry passengers from London back to India, and the right to carry passengers to the third state. So when we have you're flying to London and then you have a connecting flight to Toronto, so then you're flying from London to Toronto, so your two states become London and Toronto. So this is when you can carry your passengers from London to Toronto when neither of them are your home state. Next, we have annexures. So we have 19 annexures, and today we'll be focusing on the second one, but I'll go through the whole list. So annex one is personal licensing, which was covered yesterday. And annex two is rules of the air. Annex three is meteorological service for international air navigation. Annex four is aeronautical charts. Annex five is units of measurement. Annex six is operations of aircraft. Annex 7 is aircraft nationality and registration. Annex 8 is airworthiness of aircraft. Annex 9 is facilitation. Annex 10 is aeronautical communication. Annex 11 is air traffic services. Annex 12 is search and rescue. Annex 13 is aircraft accident or incident investigation. Annex 14 is aerodrome. Annex 15 is aeronautical information services. Annex 16 is environmental protection. Annex 17 is security safeguarding international civil aviation and unlawful interference. Annex 18 is safe transport of dangerous goods. And Annex 19 is the most recent addition, safety management. Okay, so rules of the air. Now, you cannot always just randomly fly over an area. Every state has its own list of restricted areas, prohibited areas, dangerous areas. Now, what is a restricted area? It is an airspace of a defined dimension above land areas or territorial waters of state, within which the flight of aircraft is restricted in accordance with certain specified conditions. So there, it is a land marking. It is an area that has been marked. You cannot fly over that area unless you have prior permission, or you will be given a certain time to fly, a certain time in which you can fly over that area. Then you have prohibited area, which is an airspace of defined dimensions above which the land areas or territorial waters of state, within which the flight of an aircraft is totally prohibited, which means you cannot, absolutely cannot fly over these areas. Dangerous areas or danger areas, and is an airspace defined dimensions within which activities dangerous to flight or aircraft may exist at specified times. So dangerous areas might be like a shooting range, or more specifically a shooting range where, you know, obviously a flight is dangerous. So now here I have a list of dangerous air, of prohibited areas, and till which height are they prohibited. So in Baroda is completely prohibited. Then you have Mumbai, it is 1 mile and then unlimited. Mathura refinery, Rashtrapati Bhavan, Bhuvaneshwar Tower, and Kalpakkam in Tamil Nadu. Okay. Now, this is an example of an aeronautical chart, and I will show you where. Okay, so if you see VID 109 over here, that is a dangerous area. Anything in red, marked in red, is dangerous area. Anything marked in white is restricted area. And anything marked in anything marked in white is prohibited areas, and anything marked in blue. So for example, just a second. Over here, can you see VP92? Let me try and zoom that in. Okay. VP92. So that is a restricted area. So this is how your aeronautical chart would look like, and you have a list, all the restricted areas, prohibited areas, everything will be marked. Next we have, so if by chance you enter a prohibited area or you enter a restricted area, what are you supposed to do? So first, the second you enter a prohibited area or a restricted area, you will see a series of projectiles discharged at intervals of 10 seconds showing on busting red and green lights, which means you have entered an area you're not supposed to enter. It indicates that the aircraft is flying in the vicinity of a restricted, prohibited, or danger area and should take necessary actions. Now, your actions can include, first, you will not fly further into the prohibited area. You will not descend still while you're still above the prohibited area. Will, as soon as aware of the fact, give signals such as Mayday, Mayday, Mayday by RT, that's your radio telephony, and immediately squawk distress code 7700 and land to the nearest airdrome outside the prohibited area. Now, squawk distress code is, these are codes that you can use when your communications fail, and there are a series of different codes used for different reasons. Next is right of way. So when we're driving on the roads, and when there's a car that comes from the front, we know that we have to go to our left and the car will go to their left, its own left, but it's not the same in air. Plus, you have to make the decision obviously beforehand. You can't just stop and wait for the plane in front of you to do anything. So right of way means the right to proceed without alteration of course. The aircraft that has the right of way is required to maintain its heading and speed and observe the other aircraft whilst the collision risk exists, which means if you are on the right of the aircraft, you have the right of way. So why you have to maintain your heading, you don't have to change your direction at all, but you have to make sure you're aware of the aircraft and observe the aircraft while the risk of collision still exists. Right of way approaching head on or approximately so, there is a danger of collision. Each shall alter its heading to the right. Converging, when two aircrafts are converging at approximately the same level, the aircraft that has the other on its right shall give way. So now over here you can see an image overtaking. So when you're overtaking, the aircraft ahead of you has right of way. So what you have to do is change your heading to the right and then move. Over here, the second image is two aircrafts that are converging, but this aircraft has a right of way. So you have to turn your heading to the right and then follow. And when two aircrafts are coming in head on, so both the aircrafts have to turn their heading to their own right and then move on. Okay, so overtaking, an aircraft that is being overtaken has the right of way, and the overtaking aircraft, whether climbing, descending, or horizontal flight shall keep out of the way by altering its heading to the right. Landing. An aircraft in flight or operating on ground or water shall give way to the aircraft landing or in the final stages of an approach to land. Surface movement of aircraft. In case of danger of collision between two aircraft taxiing on movement area of an aerodrome, the following shall apply. When two aircrafts are approaching head-on or approximately so, each shall stop or, where practicable, alter its course to the right so as to keep well clear. When two aircrafts are converging, on a converging course, the one which has the other on its right shall give way. An aircraft which is being overtaken by another aircraft shall have the right of way, and the overtaking aircraft shall keep well clear of the other aircraft. Next, we have lights displayed by an aircraft. So, the lights must be displayed from sunrise to sunset, which means your dawn and from dusk, your dawn time, your dusk time, and the whole night time, or whenever appropriate, deemed by the meteorological department or appropriate authorities. When, let's say, your visibility is low, that's when you need your lights on. All aircraft in flight or on the movement area of the aerodrome must display lights. Anti-collision lights intended to attract the attention of another aircraft. Navigation lights intended to indicate the relative path of the aircraft to the observer. No other lights shall be displayed if they are likely to be mistaken for navigation lights. Now, these are the lights. You have red lights, green, and white on the tail. Next, we have flight plan. Okay, so one more thing I wanted to add. If at all your collision lights are damaged, your anti-collision lights are damaged, you need to continue your flight, and after you land, you need to fix them. However, when your navigation lights are damaged, you need to immediately fix them, which means you need to land as soon as possible and fix your navigation lights. Next, we have flight plan. So, flight plan is obviously extremely important. All pilots have to plan their flight, like give a flight plan before they start. So, flight plan rule. Flights more than 5 miles from ARP. ARP is your aerodrome reference point. Above 350 AGL, which is your above ground level, 3000 feet AGL, have to file a flight plan. FPL is short for flight plan, is needed for any flight or portion of flight requiring an ATC clearance, any IFR, which is your instrument flying, IFR flight in advisory space, any advisory airspace, these are different types of airspaces, any flight where appropriate ATC service is required to provide flight information services, alerting services, and search and rescue service, where the authority has determined that a FPL should be filed to facilitate coordination between civilian and military authorities, any flight across international borders. This is what a flight plan looks like. Next, communication failure in VMC. Now, you communicate through radio telephony, like I said before. So there are times when your communications fail. Now, communication failure in VMC. VMC is visual meteorological conditions. So when your communications fail while you're flying VMC, first is you need to put a squawk code of 7600. Like I mentioned before, squawk codes are used when your radio telephony or communication fails. So 7600 is a squawk code indicating that you have communication failure. So after you put a squawk code of 7600, you should continue flying in VMC, land at the nearest suitable aerodrome. ATC is to be informed as soon as possible once the aircraft lands. So after you land, you need to go to the ATC and inform of your landing, and you will have to do a whole report. And obviously, if your communication has failed, there has to be some way to communicate between the ATC and the aircraft. So we use light signals. So a steady green light means if you're in flight, it means you're clear to land. If you're on ground, it means you're clear to take off. A steady red light means do not land. If you're in flight, it means do not land. Give way and keep circling. If you're on ground, it means to stop, immediately stop. A flashing green light in flight means return to aerodrome and wait for landing clearance. On ground means clear to taxi. Flashing red light in flight means do not land, aerodrome is unsafe or closed. And flashing red light on ground means move clear of runway or landing area. Flashing white light in flight means land on receipt of steady green, which means you need to wait for a steady green light. And on ground means return to the start point of aerodrome. Now, a red pyrotechnic or a red flare, if that is used by the ATC, it means do not withstand any previous instructions and do not land for time being. And for the aircraft to acknowledge signals, you can rock the wings. So next we have communication failure in IMC. Now IMC is your instrument meteorological conditions. So first you need to attempt to establish communication and keep a sharp lookout. Then in an airspace where a radar is not used, maintain the last assigned speed and or level for a period of 20 minutes. And then, and if you are in an airspace where the radar is used, then you maintain the last assigned speed or level for 7 minutes. So you start maintaining the speed and level after the time the last assigned level or minimum flight altitude is reached, the time the transponder is set to code 7600, which was your communication failure squawk code, and the aircraft's failure to report its position over a compulsory reporting point. So when you're flying in IMC or when you're flying IFR, there is a time limit after which you need to give a position report to the ATC. So once, let's say 15 minutes is your time minute, like the ATC will tell you to give a position report every 15 minutes or whatever time they want. So if you fail to report within 15 minutes, the ATC will obviously try to contact you once or twice, and you have different stages of missing the calls. However, so the second you fail to report your 15 minute position report, if you're flying in an airspace that does not use radar, you will maintain the assigned speed or level for about 20 minutes. And if you're flying where the radar is used, you will maintain the speed and level for a period of 7 minutes. So this is how radar looks like. This is a primary radar and this is your secondary radar. Okay. So now visual meteorological conditions, VMC. So we spoke about communication failures and VMC, right? So now what is VMC? So meteorological conditions expressed in terms of visibility, distance from clouds, ceiling to or better than specified minima. And IMC is meteorological conditions expressed in terms of visibility, distance from clouds, ceiling less than the minima specified for visual meteorological conditions. So your VMC is this. So you have to be 1,000 feet vertically clear of clouds. you need to have a 5 kilometer visibility. You need to be clear of clouds horizontally 1,500 meters, and you have to be above 3,000 feet from the ground level. This is your VMC condition. Now, when you are falling short of the VMC condition, so let's say your visibility is less than 5 kilometers, your horizontal clearance from clouds is less than 1,500, your vertical clearance is less than 1,000 feet, and let's say you're flying at 500 feet. So this is when you switch over to instrumental meteorological conditions, because you're no longer in the, you don't have the clear, or you don't have the right visibility or the distance from cloud. So you cannot fly VMC, you have to switch to IMC conditions. Okay, so these are your VFR flight rules. VFR flight rules is obviously VMC. So a VFR flight cleared by ATC, that is air traffic control, to operate within the control zone in meteorological conditions below VMC. So VMC is a certain level. So anything below VMC, as in the conditions are better than VMC, then you can fly a VFR. Visibility, the greatest distance at which a black object of suitable dimensions situated near the ground can be seen and recognized when observed against a bright background. This is your this is how good your visibility should be when you're flying VFR. The greatest distance at which lights in the vicinity of 1000 candles can be seen and identified against a unit of against an unlit background. So this is just giving you an idea of how good your visibility should be when you're flying VFR flights. Ceiling, the height above ground or water of the lowest layer of cloud below 6000 meters, that is 20,000 feet, covering more than half of the sky. Takeoff and landing. So VFR flight cannot take off or land at an aerodrome in CTR, stands for control zone, or enter an aerodrome traffic zone or traffic pattern when the ceiling is less than 1,500 feet and the visibility is less than 5 kilometers. Because when your visibility is less than 5 kilometers and your ceiling is less than 1,500 feet, you are no longer in VMC condition. You switch over to IMC. So, like I'd mentioned before, there are types of airspaces. So, we have, in India, we have airspace A, B, C, D, and E. And F and G are mostly restricted airspaces. So, airspace A is not mentioned here because airspace A does not allow VMC or VFR VFR flying. So over here, for class of airspace B, C, D, and E, your vertical limits, that it has to be above FL flight level 100, which is, and your visibility has to be 8 kilometers. Your distance from cloud has to be 1,000 feet vertical and 1,500 meters horizontal from the cloud. And AMSL is above mean sea level. And then for airspace F and G, at and below 3,000 feet mean sea level, or 1,000 feet above terrain, which is higher, your visibility has to be 5 kilometers and clear of clouds, and your surface has to be in sight, which means you need to have a clear view of your surface. Okay, then we have minimum height a VFR flight shall not be flown. So over a congested area of cities, towns, settlements, or even an open air assembly of persons at a height of less than 300 meters, which is 1,000 feet, above the highest obstacle within a radius of 600 meters from the aircraft. Elsewhere at a height of 1,500 feet or 150 meters above ground or water. So this means your minimum flight when you don't have a particular obstacle is 150 meters, which is 500 feet. And over congested areas or cities, you need to have a height of 1,000 feet above the highest obstacle within a radius of 600 meters. So your highest obstacle has to be within a radius of 600 meters from the aircraft, and your height above the highest obstacle has to be 1,000 feet. And then this is minimum height rule, which is, so this is the minimum height rule below which you cannot fly at all. And this is just a minimum, this is like a safe minimum height rule for you to fly, which is over high terrain or mountainous areas at a level which is at least 600 meters, that is 2,000 feet above the highest obstacle located within 8 kilometers of estimated position of the aircraft. Elsewhere, then as specified above, above the highest obstacle located within 8 kilometers of estimated position of the aircraft. And IFR is flown whenever the weather is below VMC and the pilot wishes to fly IFR but with proper navigational equipments on board. So you can only switch to IFR when you know that you cannot fly under VMC conditions. Okay, weather deterioration below VMC. If it becomes evident that a controlled VFR flight will not remain in VMC, the pilot is to first request an amended clearance to continue to the destination aerodrome by another route remaining in VMC, which means if you know the route that you are going on, you cannot remain in a VMC, you cannot fly in VMC, then you need to request for another route in which you can continue flying in VMC. If that is not possible, then land at the nearest unseeable aerodrome, or if operating in a control zone, request for a SVFR. SVFR means a special VFR clearance, in which you can, a special VFR is you can fly under below VMC conditions, provided it's in a control zone, or you can file for an IFR flight plan. So now we'll move on to lights and pyrotechnic signals. These are different signals given. If let's say you don't have communication between the aircraft and the ATC, or if the ATC is too busy, like there are a lot of flights, so sometimes they give light signals, sometimes they talk to you on radio. So now, steady green. Most of this I've already discussed before, but I'll still go over it. Steady green, when you're in an aircraft, you're clear to land. On ground, clear to take off. Steady red, in aircraft, you have to give way to another aircraft and continue circling. And on ground, you need to stop. A series of green flashes, which means you need to return for landing. And clear, when you're on ground, you're clear to taxi. A series of red flashes, aerodrome unsafe, do not land when you're in flight. And when you're on ground, it means taxi or taxi clear of landing area in use, which means you need to move away from the landing area which is being in use. And a series of white flashes, when you're in flight, land at this aerodrome and proceed to apron. And when you're on ground, return to starting point on the aerodrome. A red pyrotechnic, notwithstanding any previous instructions, and do not land for the time being. Okay. Now, these are how it looks like. So, the signal is given, and this is just a pictorial view of what I just explained. Okay, next I will be showing, so another signaling is marshalling signaling. So I will show a video for that right now. Signals. Next, we have ground signals. So, when you're, you'll see these signals all over the aerodrome. And so, this means this is a landing T. So this means takeoff and landing has to be in the direction of the T. Next, we have a T with a disc or a black hanging ball from a mast. T with a disc or a black hanging ball from a mast. This means the takeoff and landing direction may not be the same. Next, we have white dumbbell. This means aircraft are required to land, take off, and taxi on runways and taxiways only. Then we have white dumbbell with black perpendicular bars. This means aircraft are required to land and take off on runways only, but maneuvers need not be confined to runways and taxiways. Then we have a single yellow diagonal on a red background, this one, which means maneuvering area is poor, exercise special care when landing. Then the two yellow diagonals on a red background. The aerodrome is unsafe for the movement of aircraft and landing is prohibited, which means you're not allowed to land and the aerodrome is unsafe for like even the maneuvering and the moving around of the aircraft. Then we have a red and yellow striped right arrow or a green flag hanging from the mast, which means right hand circuit in pattern is used. Then you have a double white cross or two balls hanging from a mast, which means glider flying is in progress, so you must be ready to give that away because gliders are lighter than your aircraft, so they have priority. Then you have a black C letter on a yellow background, which indicates the location of the air traffic services reporting office. Then we have white cross on a black background, which means the runway is closed. And then we have a yellow cross, which means the taxiway is closed. And then the last one is the large L white letter, which indicates the area which is normally of grass reserved for landing and takeoff of light aircrafts. Okay, so this is all I have for today. I hope you